By the time the U-2 aerial reconnaissance plane was ready to fly in the spring of 1956, President Eisenhower was still unconvinced that okaying the mission was the right move. He worried that if a plane was somehow downed over Soviet territory, even though everyone involved said it couldn't happen, that the Soviets would have a field day, claiming unfairness, aggression, and ruthlessness on both the part of himself and the United States. He worried an incident would start another world war. For all the technical challenges the U-2 presented, the political decisions were among the biggest, and it turned out Eisenhower's instinct to be wary was right. Hello everyone, I'm Amy. This is The Vintage Space, my little corner of the internet where we talk about all things mid-century that, quite frankly, interest me, like Cold War aerial espionage. Welcome to part two in this series covering the U-2, the Corona satellites, and the A-12/Oxcart/SR-71. Part one is right here. If you haven't seen it, I'd recommend checking it out before watching this video, just to get the backstory of why high-altitude spy planes became necessary. And as this series is a deep dive, it might contain more detail than you already know, and it will also introduce you to some of our major players. So with all that said, let's pick things back up with the first CL-282, which was the U-2's original designation, just about ready to fly. In the spring of 1955, the CL-282 was getting close to test flights, which meant the program needed a testing site. There was no question of flying it out of Lockheed's Burbank facility. Though there was a runway, it was far too publicly exposed an area, not to mention potentially disastrous to test an unconventional design over a major city. On April 12, 1955, Richard Bissell, who was heading the program for the CIA, Colonel Osman Ritland, the senior U.S. Air Force officer on the project, Kelly Johnson, the CL-282's main designer, and Lockheed test pilot Tony Levere flew out over Nevada to look for a good site. They found an airstrip by a salt flat called Groom Lake near the northeast corner of the Atomic Energy Commission's Nevada Proving Ground that turned out to be an old World War II aerial gunnery training site for the Army Air Corps. Bissell got the AEC to add Groom Lake to its real estate holdings, and the site was named for its map designation, Area 51. Kelly Johnson loved the site, but didn't like the clinical sound of the name, so he nicknamed it Paradise Ranch, in the hopes that it would be more appealing to the workers who would soon be spending a lot of their time in the remote part of the desert. One of the first things the team built was a paved runway, which was much safer than compacted ground when rain from the nearby mountains flooded the old lake bed, which it did, earning the runway its own nickname of Watertown Strip. As the planes neared the end of construction in Burbank, special terminology was put in place to keep things secretive as they left the factory. The planes were called articles, and the pilots referred to as drivers in all communications. In cable traffic, the aircraft were referred to as KW Extra, with a two-digit number identifying the specific vehicle. The pilots were similarly referenced as KW Glitter, with a two-digit number identifying the individual. The idea was, if anything fell into the wrong hands, it wouldn't be obvious what the transmission was even referring to. Paradise Ranch was ready when, on July 25, 1955, the wings and tail of CL-282 Article 341 were removed, the pieces wrapped in a tarpaulin, and loaded onto a C-124 for transport to the desert site. The plane wasn't quite the final version. The camera was the preliminary A-1 iteration, and the engines were the Pratt & Whitney J-75/P-37 engines, a power plant that was 276 pounds heavier and 20% less efficient than the J-57/P-31 engine designed for the CL-282. But for the moment, the Air Force didn't have any to spare. They were all installed in reconfigured Canberras. Nevertheless, the new plane was ready to fly. Once Article 341 arrived and was reassembled, it needed a name. There would be a cover story circulated, since people would doubtless see it in the skies, so it needed a publicly safe designation. Colonel Almon T. Culbertson and Lieutenant Colonel Geary looked through aircraft designer handbooks. They knew it couldn't be a bomber, fighter, or transport designation, and they didn't want to give it any name that would even hint that it was a reconnaissance plane either. They ultimately decided the best way to hide the plane's true identity was to hide it in plain sight and call it a utility plane. There were already two on the books, the U-1 and the U-3, which meant the CL-282 fit into this theme, redesignated as the U-2. The same month the first U-2s arrived in the Nevada desert, Eisenhower took steps to make it an unnecessary program altogether. At the Geneva summit on July 21, 1955, he presented Open Skies. This proposal called for an agreement of overflights between the United States and the Soviet bloc so both countries would know the other's capabilities. Eisenhower offered to provide information about airfields and other U.S. facilities for the Soviets to conduct aerial photography if the Soviets would do the same for their installations. As Eisenhower wrote in his memoirs, quote, "If taken seriously and agreed to by the Soviets, it would have done much to reduce this danger to the United States and the chances of a global war. I'll give it one shot," he said. "Then, if they don't accept it, we'll fly the U-2. The proposal was never taken seriously by the Soviet delegation. Khrushchev passed on the idea immediately. The Soviets' refusal of Open Skies pushed the U-2 program forward. With missions more firmly on the books, finalizing the inter-service arrangement was the next step. On August 3, 1955, Director of Central Intelligence Alan Dulles and Air Force Chief of Staff Nathan Twining signed the agreement on organization and delineation of responsibilities for Project Oilstone, Oilstone being the Air Force's codename designed to hide its crossover with the CIA name being Project Aquatone. Edwin Land, one of the most vocal supporters behind the U-2 program from the start, recommended establishing a permanent task force of Air Force and agency personnel to develop and coordinate mission requirements. This need spawned the Ad Hoc Requirements Committee established December 1, 1955, with James Q. Reber as Intelligence Requirements Officer for the program and as Chairman of the Ad Hoc Requirements Committee, which met for the first time on February 1 of 1956. All parties involved agreed that the main targets should be long-range bombers, guided missiles, and nuclear energy installations. CIA representatives generally focused on strategic intelligence, aircraft and munitions factories, power plants, nuclear establishments, roads, bridges, and inland waterways. And because the CIA was the major shareholder in the program, as it were, its needs weighed heaviest. The military representatives, on the other hand, focused on order of battle data. The U.S. Air Force wanted intelligence on the location of Soviet and Eastern Bloc radar setups and airfields. Exploitation of the overhead photography fell under a new project, Project Equine. Under the Oilstone Agreement, the CIA assumed responsibility for the camera, the security, contracting, film processing, and all arrangements at foreign bases. Managing the gathered intelligence was subcontracted to the Eastman Kodak Company that would process the film between its Rochester plant and CIA headquarters. It would be interpreted by the CIA, then shared with appropriate parties as needed. As the final pieces of the program fell into place, the U-2 took its first steps into the sky. The first taxi test on July 27, 1955, had Tony Levere at the controls and saw the plane reach just 50 knots. On August 1st, Levere got up to 70 knots to start feeling out the ailerons, and midway through the test, realized, to his utter astonishment, that he was airborne. The unintentional flight turned out to be something of a tradition for Lockheed planes. He immediately tried to land, but couldn't figure out how high he was off the ground. There weren't any markings on the lake bed to help him judge distance or altitude. He managed to touch down, but dangerously, in a 10-degree bank. The first official flight came on August 4th, again with Levere, and it taught him that the most consistent way to land was with the rear wheel touching down first, then easing the rest of the plane onto the runway. The first official flight came 4 days later on August 8, 1955. Kelly Johnson, Richard Bissell, Colonel Osmond Ritland, Richard Horner, and Garrison Norton were all in attendance. The U-2 flew to 32,000 feet and performed well. All program deadlines for delivery and proof of airworthiness had officially been met. Further test flights explored the stall envelope, stress limits, and speed potential of the plane. On September 8th, it hit the 65,600-foot design ceiling. Though largely successful, these tests did reveal the first issues with the U-2. On September 22nd, the engine flamed out at 64,000 feet, restarted, then flamed out again at 60,000 feet. The interim P-31 just didn't have the restart capability of the P-37, and it was clearly not up to the task of the U-2 flights, but it was all the plane had for the moment. Nevertheless, by and large, the flight tests were successful enough for Lockheed to set up a true production line at the Skunk Works facility in Burbank. At the same time, activity picked up at the Groom Lake site. With more planes testing, project personnel had to figure out transferring crews and necessary personnel to Area 51, CIA and Air Force personnel, as well as Lockheed employees, all without arousing suspicion. The solution was to fly them out on Monday and back home Friday on an Air Force C-57 military transport service aircraft. It was quickly dubbed Bissell's Narrow Gauge Airline. With the planes coming off the assembly lines and necessary personnel taking up part-time residence in the desert, the final piece of the puzzle was the pilots. As per the CIA Air Force contract, pilot selection fell to the latter, with the former having a say in the final roster. There was some argument early on in the program that U-2 pilots should be non-American to further hide the plane's true nature if it was downed over enemy territory, but that turned out to be better in theory than in practice. Some discussion on this point is still classified, but technical experience was one issue barring non-Americans. Pilots from other countries just didn't have the same specialized background as the U.S. Air Force pilots that the CIA wanted flying these dangerous missions. Language was also another barrier with some nations. A handful of foreign pilots were interviewed and some even made a few test flights, but the idea of using non-American pilots was abandoned in autumn of 1955. Lieutenant General Emmett Rosie O'Donnell, the Air Force Deputy Chief of Staff, eventually authorized Air Force pilots to fly for the U-2 program. But the pool was limited to Strategic Air Command pilots with reserve assignments. No regular pilots were up for consideration because of the challenge of getting them through the resignation process without arousing suspicion. Even for SAC pilots, it wasn't easy. They had to be willing to resign and assume civilian status, a process known as sheep dipping. Many wanted the challenge of the U-2, but were afraid of losing their military careers and ranks. As compensation, and to make the prospect more alluring, they were offered better pay and the promise of reinstatement to the Air Force once their time with the U-2 was finished. Once the procedures were in place, the actual selection was quite rigorous. Anyone with a nervous disposition was immediately deselected. Those who passed were screened at the Lovelace Clinic under the direction of aviation medicine pioneer Dr. Randy Lovelace. Here, they underwent extensive testing to uncover any physical or psychological issues. The few who made it past this phase and then met the CIA's requirements began training at Area 51 under Tony Levere, who was the only person who had actually flown the plane. Levere quickly found that teaching someone to fly this half-jet, half-glider was complicated and made more challenging by there being no two-seat training model. He instructed new pilots on the ground and hoped they would remember it all once they were up in the air. For the pilots, the U-2 was so challenging because it was so unique. The first U-2s could not fly faster than 190 knots at sea level in smooth air or 150 knots in rough air. At operational altitude, going faster than Mach 0.8 could bring fatal stresses to the airframe. Even for seasoned fighter pilots, managing airspeed was challenging and critical. Only 6 knots separated the speed where the U-2 would stall from where it would go over speed, both situations leading to stresses on the airframe that could literally rip the plane apart. This is the infamous coffin corner. Even navigation was new for a lot of pilots. They had to learn to use a sextant for celestial fixes in case cloud cover made ground tracking with the periscope impossible. But most had success with dead reckoning and were able to fly with an error of less than 1 nautical mile over a 1,000 nautical mile course. By September of 1955, there were 6 qualified U-2 pilots ready to fly. The future of the program as a whole, however, was very uncertain. On December 27, 1955, President Eisenhower approved Project Genetrix, a high-altitude photo reconnaissance program using balloons. The setup was simple. Balloons carrying automatic cameras were released over Eastern Europe, the Soviet Union, and the People's Republic of China. Ballast was triggered to drop according to a preset timer, bringing the balloon's payload back to Earth. It was, on the whole, a crude and imperfect system. By the end of February 1956, the Air Force had launched 516 balloons, 46 of whose payloads were recovered, and just 34 yielded useful results. Winds meant some balloons didn't pass over their targets and a handful were shot down, and human error setting some of the timers meant the ballast released early and the balloons came down in enemy territory. The Soviets were able to collect this American spy technology, everything from the polyethylene gas bags, cameras, and even the transmitters, to figure out exactly what its enemy's capability was. The retrieved objects were put out for the world press in an embarrassing display. The Soviets also directly profited from these missions. One roll of Genetrix's film ended up returning the first ever pictures of the lunar far side when the Soviets used it in the Luna 3 spacecraft. But more problematic than spy technologies falling into enemy hands was the negative publicity that came from these balloons. The U.S. Air Force circulated the story that they were weather balloons gathering high-altitude data for the International Geophysical Year, the year of cooperative science between international nations. But the downed balloons destroyed that story. The Soviet Union sent formal protests to the United States on behalf of countries where balloons were lost, some of which claimed those flying over Eastern Europe even endangered civilian aircraft. Eisenhower was hugely upset by the results of Genetrix, ultimately feeling that, quote, the balloons gave more legitimate grounds for irritation than could be matched by the good obtained from them. He ordered the program stopped, and on February 7, 1956, Allen Dulles said there would be no more flights, but he also didn't apologize to the Soviet nations. Though Genetrix was plagued by political problems, the method totally unreliable, and the images mediocre at best, it nevertheless represented the best intelligence that the U.S. had. The program had also inadvertently gathered information on Soviet bloc radar systems. The 91-centimeter steel bar that supported the gas bag, camera, and ballast equipment turned out, purely by chance, to correspond to the radio frequency used by the Soviet token system. It resonated when hit by the Soviet radar. This unintended effect allowed the United States and NATO to find radar tracking stations in Soviet countries they hadn't known about earlier, revealing what the U-2 would be up against when it finally flew. America was getting a clearer picture of what was going on behind the Iron Curtain, but for Eisenhower, the political risk still outweighed the need for new data. He nixed any further balloon programs, and the CIA began to worry that Genetrix's failure would impact the president's feelings on the whole U-2 program. While Genetrix was embroiled in controversy, the U-2 took definitive steps towards mission readiness. In anticipation of photo reconnaissance that would impact policy decisions, Dulles brought key members of Congress into Project Aquatone in February of 1956. At the same time, Richard Bissell worked out the cover story with the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics. NACA President Hugh Dryden agreed to the cover story that the U-2 was flying high-altitude weather research and upper atmospheric sampling flights. The rationale was said to be preparing for nuclear fallout in the atmosphere from atomic testing, which really was a valid concern at the time. This cover story also worked to keep subcontractors on a need-to-know basis. When Kelly Johnson ordered altimeters calibrated to 80,000 feet for the U-2, it raised some eyebrows because the manufacturer, Coleman, usually calibrated the instruments to 45,000 feet. Saying it was for an experimental space plane was a very simple explanation. For the sake of protection, the cover story itself was treated as though it was classified. Everyone in the know was barred from discussing it by phone, and anyone who asked too many questions was reported to program security personnel. In early April of 1956, the advanced A2 camera James G. Baker had been working on since 1954 was finally ready. This system pioneered the use of software algorithms to model and perfect lenses and design around the variations that would pop up from specific lens curvature, spacing, and different glass compounds. The A2 emerged as a trimetragon system, three separate K38 framing cameras with 24-inch f-stop 8 focal lenses using 9.5-inch film magazines, one right oblique, one left oblique, and one vertical. There was also one 3-inch tracking camera. On the whole, the A12 marked a 240% improvement over the earlier A1 model. This new camera system was installed in the U-2, and the updated planes made flights over the continental U.S. to test the flight and camera systems in tandem, and the veil of secrecy shrouding the U-2 started lifting away. Every overflight brought a chance that the pilot would need to make an emergency landing before getting back safely to Area 51. To give him a safe course of action, the CIA sent sealed briefings to commanders at every Air Force base with strict instructions not to open it unless expressly ordered to do so. Inside were need-to-know details about the unfamiliar plane so that when it landed, it wouldn't be a shock. The envelope also held procedures to get as many personnel away from the runway as possible, so the fewest pairs of eyes would see the plane. Another consideration was other pilots seeing it in the sky, military and civilian alike. At the time, planes were not flying at 60,000 feet. The CIA knew that pilots seeing a glint of metal where metal wasn't supposed to be would raise alarms. And there were sightings. Events pilots saw in flight were recorded and sent to the Air Force's Project Blue Book staff, who checked every one of them against U-2 flight logs. This final phase of at-home flight tests also saw the first fatality. On May 15, 1956, pilot Wilburn S. Rose had trouble dropping the wing pogos. He shook the left one loose on a low pass over the runway, but stalled turning to make a second pass to shake the right one loose and crashed. He was killed and the plane disintegrated. There was, however, a razor-thin silver lining to the incident. That the plane was destroyed gave program managers increased confidence that an intercept over enemy territory wouldn't leave any traces. They felt sure the U-2 secrets would die with the plane. Only Eisenhower remained trepidatious. As he wrote in his memoirs, "Of all those concerned, I was the only principal who consistently expressed a conviction that if ever one of the planes fell into Soviet territory, a wave of excitement mounting almost to panic would sweep the world, inspired by the standard Soviet claim of injustice, unfairness, aggression, and ruthlessness." Test flights confirmed the U-2's operational altitude of 72,000 feet, meaning it would fly safely beyond the reach of all known anti-aircraft weapons and interceptors. The A-2 camera, too, had been confirmed to have better resolution than anything that preceded it. But the plane's range of 2,950 miles wasn't enough to fly to the Soviet Union or another Eastern European target from American soil. Richard Bissell needed a European base from which to mount missions and settled on Lakenheath Air Force Base in the UK, a Royal Air Force base also used by the US Air Force Strategic Air Command. The first group, Detachment A, started deploying to the English site on April 29, 1956, and by May 4th, four aircraft, four pilots, and all the required personnel to keep things running were at Lakenheath. Publicly, the group was the First Weather Reconnaissance Squadron Provisional. The provisional designation was a security thing. Provisional groups didn't have to report to higher authorities. The NACA released a press alert on May 7, 1956 to corroborate this cover story. The group was officially studying the jet stream, convective clouds, temperature and winds at the jet stream level, as well as cosmic ray effects up to 55,000 feet. But not long after the Americans' arrival, Anglo-Soviet relations became strained. In mid-April, a Soviet naval squadron brought Sergei Khrushchev and Nikolai Bulganin to the UK. While the ships were docked at Portsmouth, Commander Lionel Crabb undertook a mission to investigate the hulls of these Soviet vessels and disappeared. His headless body later washed up on a beach. The so-called Frogman incident caused an uproar in British Parliament that was met with protests from Moscow. The whole thing scared Prime Minister Anthony Eden, who asked President Eisenhower on May 16th to hold off launching any Soviet overflights from the English base, lest a tracked mission make Anglo-Soviet relationships worse. 2 days later, a U-2 on a training flight flew into a British radar network and caused the RAF to scramble, thinking the plane was an enemy intruder. This strained Anglo-American relations. It was only then that Richard Bissell learned that the U.S. State Department had told Prime Minister Eden there was only one U-2 in the UK, not the four that were really there. Bissell became wary of putting more strain on Anglo-American relations, so moved Detachment A to Wiesbaden, Germany on June 11, 1956. This was one of the busiest airfields in the country, and he did it without telling the German government. He reasoned that it was temporary while the CIA prepared Geiselstadt, an old World War II base that had served as a launch site for the Genetrix balloons. Once the four U-2s arrived in Wiesbaden, they were finally fitted with the upgraded J-57/P-31 engines and renamed the U-2B. Finally, Bissell had everything in place, a detachment close to the Soviet target nations, and multiple pilots to fly the multiple planes, all fitted with updated engines and cameras. All he needed was approval to fly, and fast. There was a window of good weather between June 20th and July 10th. On May 28th, Alan Dulles met with Eisenhower to discuss overflights, but the president still didn't give his approval. He remained deeply concerned with the risk of international backlash and increased stresses on already tense American-Soviet relations. He knew the flight would just bring new hostilities. The CIA once again affirmed that its best intelligence said the Soviets were unlikely to track the U-2 consistently enough to intercept or otherwise engage with it. A vulnerability report said the Soviets' max radar detection was 55,000 feet. But that information was based on World War II-era radars and on testing with US radars, which the CIA assumed were more sophisticated than what the USSR would have. These assurances failed to alleviate Eisenhower's fears of what might happen if a plane crashed. He wasn't even comforted with the CIA's conviction that both plane and pilot wouldn't leave enough evidence to be traced back to the United States. But the need for intelligence to confirm or disprove Soviet advances in long-range missiles and bombers was growing. Sightings suggesting the Soviets had as many as 30 Bison bombers were eventually proved false. It turned out that the same 10 planes made multiple passes at an air show to present the image of a larger fleet. But there was still concern over Soviet guided missiles. U.S. intelligence knew the Soviets had tested a missile with a range of 900 miles, which put it technologically ahead in some areas of development. That fear was compounded when Khrushchev announced on April 23rd that, quote, "I am quite sure that we shall have very soon a guided missile with a hydrogen bomb warhead which could hit any point in the world." The Americans couldn't risk being unprepared for a Soviet attack, or being baited into reacting to Soviet power that wasn't real. The growing need finally pushed Eisenhower over the edge. He authorized 10 days of overflights in July of 1956. On Wednesday, June 20th, 1956, Carl K. Overstreet flew a test mission over Poland and Germany. Radars did see the plane, but misread the altitude as 42,000 feet. It seemed the U-2 was able to avoid true detection, but that still didn't say anything about Soviet radar systems. When Eisenhower learned the result of this first flight, his attention shifted to tracking. If the plane could be spotted on radar, could they at least successfully avoid being tracked? The CIA couldn't give Eisenhower an answer. All analysts could say for sure was the altitude was safely above radar range, and the film developed by the Photo Intelligence Division revealed good quality images. Getting ever so slightly more comfortable with overflights, Eisenhower set a time frame. Khrushchev had invited a U.S. Air Force delegation to the Moscow Air Show that opened on June 23rd. Eisenhower didn't want any Soviet overflights until the U.S. delegation had left Russia. The last thing Eisenhower wanted was to make sure West German Chancellor Konrad Adenauer was informed ahead of time. He did not want a repeat of the half-truths told to a fellow leader. The question of whether the Soviets could track the U-2 still wasn't settled when Hervey Stockman left Wiesbaden on the morning of July 4th, 1956. He flew over Poznan, Poland, then Belarusia, then headed north towards Leningrad before the final leg over the Soviet Baltic states. He covered his main target of naval shipyards in Leningrad, as well as a handful of airfields to make an inventory of new Bison bombers. Carmine Vito followed a similar path the next day, but flew further east, going more than 200 kilometers past Moscow, also hunting for bisons. Two daring flights right out the gate was Richard Bissell's idea. He reasoned it would never be safer to fly over Moscow than while the Americans still had the element of surprise. The Soviets detected these initial overflights, but it seemed they couldn't track them well, and attempts to intercept the U-2s were unsuccessful. Buoyed by these early successes, Detachment A made three more overflights, two on July 9th over Eastern Europe, Belarusia, and the Soviet Union, and one on July 10th over the Crimean Peninsula. The first eight flights beyond the Iron Curtain, five of which entered Soviet airspace, brought back valuable intelligence. Photographs revealed that the Soviet Union did not have the more than 100 Bison bombers it claimed, revealing the bomber gap was less of a gap and more just propaganda. Photographs also revealed just how well the Soviets were able to track the U-2. Images showed MiG-15s and MiG-17s as tiny dots well below the U-2, but obviously in pursuit of it at attack altitudes. Some photos showed the Soviet jets flipped over and falling after what looked like failed attempts to rise to the U-2's altitude. It was clear the Soviet defense system could track the plane well enough to get close, but it remained safely out of reach. Dreams of a hidden reconnaissance flight were well and truly dashed when a formal protest note reached the U.S. Embassy in Moscow. But interestingly for the United States, the note revealed that the Soviets didn't really know what they were dealing with. The U-2 was described as a twin-engine medium bomber. They didn't seem to think a single-engine plane could fly that high. And the note said it was operated by the U.S. Air Force. It listed the route, but failed to mention Leningrad or Moscow. Nevertheless, the Soviets did identify the flight as very obviously, quote, intentional and conducted for the purposes of intelligence. The note arrived at the White House on the evening of July 10th, leaving Eisenhower deeply unnerved. He immediately ordered Richard Bissell to stop all overflights until further notice. General Andrew Jackson Goodpaster, Eisenhower's staff secretary, told Allen Dulles that he wasn't allowed to mention, quote, the existence of the project or of operation incident to it outside the executive branch. The president wanted to manage the number of people who knew about this act of aggression and was especially keen to keep it out of the public eye. More than the Soviet reaction, he was worried that the American people would be angry about the overflights, and he knew their dissent would be harder to manage than the Soviet protests. Eisenhower's enthusiasm for the U-2 program quickly waned, much to Richard Bissell's chagrin. He thought the caliber of photographs was worth the risk. Bissell was so keen to continue flights that he initiated a program to shrink the U-2's radar cross-section so it would be harder for the Soviets to track. This begat Project HT Namable, which established a proprietary firm called the Scientific Engineering Institute, led by former Air Force Colonel Richard S. Leghorn, the man who had first pushed the service to consider high-altitude photoreconnaissance in the 1950s. Experiments with radar-absorbing materials began on November 26th under Project Rainbow. A first attempted solution was fitting bamboo, then fiberglass poles on the wings, but this trapeze arrangement failed to scramble radar signals and lowered the U-2's operational ceiling. The next solution was a plastic wallpaper containing a printed design that absorbed radar pulses between 65 and 85 megahertz glued to the fuselage nose and tail. This brought a significant weight and drag penalty, and in one test, caused the engine to overheat, killing test pilot Robert Syker. It seemed the U-2's inherent altitude advantage was, for the moment, its best defense. Soviet overflight stalled when, on July 26, 1956, Egyptian President Gamal Abdel Nasser nationalized the Suez Canal Company. This was a retaliatory move against the US and the UK for withdrawing financial support for the Aswan Dam project. To get a bird's-eye view of the situation as it developed, the US set up a second U-2 operation, Detachment B, based at the Incirlik Air Base in Adana, Turkey. Operating under the cryptonym KW Cork and under the guise of the 2nd Weather Reconnaissance Squadron Provisional, these U-2 missions flew over Greece, Israel, Egypt, Lebanon, Syria, Turkey, and the Gaza Strip. Film from these missions was flown back to the United States for development and interpretation, then shared with the British government to help both nations navigate the crisis. This new usage for the U-2 meant it was suddenly expected to perform like a tactical reconnaissance program, monitoring a developing situation around the clock. To keep to this new continuous schedule, managers had to establish a new program to develop the film on site. Project HT Automat saw a new development of photo interpreting set up in Western Germany. On September 17, 1956, Deputy Director of the CIA Charles Cable and Richard Bissell met with Eisenhower at the White House to ask permission for more Soviet flights. Their argument was the same, that photo intelligence was worth the risk. Neither Cable nor Bissell cared about world opinion. They instead stressed that the U-2 might not stay safe from Soviet interception for long, so the time to act was sooner rather than later. But Alan Dulles was also growing wary of the political ramifications of continued penetration into Soviet airspace. He was on the fence, but still leaning more towards overflights before they became too risky. While key players in the U.S. argued over the continuation of overflights, the situation in Eastern Europe escalated. The Soviet Union backed away from a confrontation with communist leaders in Poland, only to find a similar situation in Hungary, and this time Nikita Khrushchev ordered troops to suppress the uprising. Eisenhower, newly re-elected for a second term in office and watching the situation from afar, denied any U-2 flights over the crisis, but seeing such hostile aggression from the Soviets pushed him over the edge. He knew world opinion was that the United States occupied such a positive position as a military power, something it hadn't really had since the end of the war, and that overflights risked costing the country that privileged position. He was also worried about his reputation. He was known for his honesty when negotiating with other leaders, and he didn't want to jeopardize something he knew was vital to his maintaining America's relations and image. Damaging this asset for some pictures hardly seemed worth it. Torn between his desire to maintain a correct and moral status and his need to know what the Soviets were doing, Eisenhower found an acceptable middle ground. Overflights of Eastern Europe and along the Soviet border, but without penetrating Soviet airspace. The first mission in this resumed Soviet program came on November 20, 1956. Gary Powers flew along the Soviet-Iranian border, drawing Soviet interceptors who again failed to reach the U-2. The flight garnered another protest note and led Eisenhower to halt all Soviet flights on December 18th in an attempt to ease growing tensions. But border flights continued, and on March 18, 1957, one accidentally entered Soviet airspace. Pilot James W. Charbonneau got lost in heavy clouds and only realized where he was when he saw Soviet interceptors trying to reach him. The stall in Soviet overflights led the U.S. Air Force to try and wrest control of the entire U-2 program. It had its own growing fleet of U-2s, but Richard Bissell fought back to, quote, maintain greater security, employ deeper cover, and use civilian pilots, keep the aircraft outside military control, and therefore make possible more plausible denial of U.S. military responsibility in the face of any Soviet charges. Eisenhower similarly rejected the Air Force's proposal to undertake its own reconnaissance missions, appeasing the service by okaying peripheral flights near the Kamchatka Peninsula and Lake Baikal. He also okayed missions near the Soviets' atomic testing area at Semipalatinsk to see where the Soviets were reportedly testing nuclear missiles. On June 8, 1957, a U-2 took off from Eielson Air Force Base in Alaska on the first intentional Soviet overflight since Eisenhower had called them off a half a year earlier. This also marked the first flight of Detachment C, officially Weather Reconnaissance Squadron Provisional 3, the Far East Division that was set to move to the Naval Air Station in Atsugi, Japan. U.S. intelligence said the Soviets' Far East radar network was less sophisticated than what existed along its western borders, offering a potentially safer entry point for American overflights. At the same time, growing concern over Soviet missiles led to a new base of operations for Detachment B at the airfield at Lahore in Pakistan. Operation Soft Touch was designed to look for Soviet guided missiles and evidence of nuclear programs. The first Soft Touch flight left on August 5, 1957, with Buster Edens in the cockpit. He managed to photograph the Soviet Space Launch Facility east of the Aral Sea in Kazakhstan, revealing for the first time that it was close to the village of Tyuratam and not Baikonur, though that was the name the Soviets used for it. Baikonur was, in reality, more than 200 miles north. Follow-up flights on August 20th and 21st flew over the nuclear site at Semipalatinsk and revealed a new missile test center at Sari Shagan. This was where radar was tested against incoming missiles fired from Kapustin Yar, 1,400 miles away. It wasn't until August 23rd that the Air Force Chief of Staff told Eisenhower about Soft Touch. While the president was happy to have the information, he denied further overflights. But it quickly became obvious the reconnaissance was vital. 3 days later, on August 26th, the Soviet news agency TASS released a statement confirming that a super long-range, multi-stage ICBM had been successfully tested and was now possible to send missiles to any part of the world. U-2 flights were able to confirm that there was only one launch pad to fire these missiles. Throughout the summer and fall of 1957, the majority of Soviet overflights were done by Detachment B in Adana and Detachment C in Atsugi. They were less risky as starting points than Detachment A in Wiesbaden, since Soviet radar and defenses were strongest along that western border. But activity was starting to slow down by November. Eisenhower reinstated his ban on Soviet overflights, allowing only border flights, and issued a very strict warning against violating Soviet airspace. Once again, seeking to ease Soviet-American tensions, Eisenhower sent the USSR a note calling for a mutual study of technical elements to safeguard against a surprise attack. He was especially concerned about Soviet nuclear atmospheric testing. Khrushchev remained unwilling to strike a deal with the US, but did pursue a peace treaty with East Germany in November of 1958, a new crisis that made the US even warier of darting into Soviet airspace. The U-2 program was back in limbo. By the time Operation Soft Touch was drawing to a close, Bissell's promised 2 years of overflights free from Soviet intervention were up. He and U-2 program managers had to acknowledge that the Soviets were developing new technologies that could pose a real threat to the high-flying plane. The new MiG-19 and MiG-21 could climb higher than previous iterations, and the new high-altitude Mandrake R, or Yak-25RM, an improved version of the Yakovlev-25 all-weather interceptor, was also a threat. The Soviets were getting that much closer to the U-2's operational altitude. New American intelligence also found out how the Soviets were learning to attack the U-2. The MiG's tactic was to fly on the same compass heading as the U-2, but 10,000 feet below it. The pilot would then dive with a fully open throttle to gain speed, then pull back and zoom up as high as possible. The goal was to get right under the U-2 long enough to use guns and missiles before falling. The MiG just couldn't operate at that altitude for long. The U-2 pilots now worried that a MiG would actually collide with their spy plane on this aggressive upward swoop. Recognizing that they were effectively sitting ducks, they asked for a camouflaging layer of black paint that could hide the metal plane against the black canopy of space. The lull in Soviet overflight saw a development elsewhere in the program, notably the inclusion of British pilots at Detachment B in Adana. For Eisenhower, British pilots helped mitigate some of the political risk of further overflights. For Bissell, it meant he could appeal to another authority for permission for these overflights. But it wasn't a new arm of the American program. The British pilots flew a U-2 signed over to their government, and British authorities were more interested in Middle Eastern missions that had more immediate implications for European nations. The advent of the space age brought new concerns from behind the Iron Curtain. When the Soviets launched Sputnik on October 4, 1957, the new concern was over the R-7 rocket that launched it. Additional satellite launches, coupled with Soviet boasts about successful missile tests, fueled American fears. On December 4, 1958, a Soviet delegate to the Geneva Convention on Surprise Attacks stated that Soviet ICBMs are at present in mass production. 5 days later, Khrushchev said that the Soviet ICBM could carry a 5-megaton nuclear warhead 8,000 miles. That same month, a U.S. test of the Titan ICBM failed, fueling more fears that the Americans were falling behind. It was the bomber gap all over again. No one knew if the disparity between countries was real or propaganda. By early 1959, the Defense Department was pushing Eisenhower for more overflights to settle the question of the missile gap. Though Eisenhower was keen to wait for the Corona satellite program to be flight ready, orbital satellites would be well above airspace violations, he eventually relented. Sort of. On April 10th, Eisenhower approved Soviet overflights, but withdrew his approval 2 days later, opting instead to pursue negotiation talks. But when negotiations, once again, proved fruitless, he approved two electronic intelligence, or ELINT, missions on June 9th and 18th, 1959, that were joint U-2 RB-57D Canberra missions. Alan Dulles and Richard Bissell again appealed to Eisenhower on July 7, 1959. They wanted a penetration flight, and they got their approval. 2 days later, one U-2 flew a diversionary mission along the Soviet-Iranian border, while a second mission flew from Peshawar, Pakistan, over the Ural Mountains and found that the Soviets were expanding to Uratam. Those few missions didn't immediately lead to more. Nikita Khrushchev was scheduled to visit the U.S. from September 15th to 27th, and Eisenhower didn't want to strain relations more before that meeting. But Soviet progress in space with the Luna 2 mission brought more boasting about its missile power. By the end of the year, the Soviet premier was announcing that his country had, quote, such a stock of rockets, such an amount of atomic and hydrogen weapons, that if they attack us, we could wipe our potential enemies off the face of the Earth. He added, in 1 year, 250 rockets with hydrogen warheads came off the assembly line in the factory we visited. Eisenhower still refused to allow Soviet overflights, but the British government had fewer qualms. In December of 1959, RAF pilot Robert Robinson flew from Peshawar over Kyibyshev, Saratov Engels Airfield, and Kapustin Yar, but he didn't pass over to Uratam, leaving the Soviet missile question unanswered. By the beginning of 1960, Dulles was desperate for information about the Soviet SS-6 Sapwood missile installations. He wanted to fly over Soviet sites and follow nearby railway lines that might be transporting materials or even finished missiles to other launch sites in the country. Without presidential approval, CIA and military planners pushed forward, and in mid-February presented Eisenhower with plans for 4 additional U-2 Soviet missions. Detection when flying from the Peshawar base was increasingly likely, they advised, so the time to act was now. On March 28, 1960, Eisenhower consented to one penetration flight as early as April. Within this time frame, he had 2 options. Operation Grand Slam called for a flight south to north from Peshawar, flying over Tyuratam, Sverdlovsk, Kirov, Kotlas, Severodvinsk, and Murmansk before landing in Norway. Operation Time Step called for a U-2 to fly from the Air Force Base in Thule, Greenland, over Novaya Zemlya, then follow railways from the Poly-Arni Ural Mountains to Kotlas, passing over Murmansk before landing at either Bodø or Andøya on Norway. Time Step was considered less desirable. The route was thought to have a 90% chance of detection and accurate tracking, which at the very least would lead to a detailed diplomatic protest. The same issues weren't raised for Grand Slam. Eisenhower approved Grand Slam on the condition that it fly by May 1st of 1960 at the very latest. He didn't want anything to sour relations too close before the Paris summit, which was scheduled to begin on May 16th. With the mission finally approved, CIA planners began working on the details for Operation Grand Slam. That is where we're going to end things for now. Like I said, this is part of a larger series. Up next, we're going to be diving into the Powers incident, looking at detail at what happened on that mission and what effects it had on the U-2 program and the Cold War as a whole. After that, and after a break for the holidays, it'll be the Corona satellites, and finally the A-12/Oxcart/SR-71. Quick reminder that my new book, Fighting for Space, is available however you like to consume books, as is my first, Breaking the Chains of Gravity. I have links for both of those in the description below. A special shout out to all my Patreon backers and YouTube members. You guys truly make these videos possible. So thank you so much for your ongoing support. If you would like to help keep the Vintage Space up and running and also get access to my Space Center Discord, I've got the link you need in the description below. And of course, links on how to connect across social media as well. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me today, and I'll see you next time.